I just ask one question. Where will the millions and millions of dollars that are spent for the research and development of these drugs come from? They will not come from the government. The government has failed, as we see in 1991, where the LPG policy was brought in. Please answer.
So, patents are not only the way for the innovation. You can have other ways through which you can start innovation. Now, the first thing, I would like to give you an example of one of the pharmaceutical company, non-profit pharmaceutical company existing in USA, One World Health. Its name is One World Health. So what this particular pharmaceutical company does is that it takes help from the non-governmental organizations, from the health ministers of various nations, and it takes the fund from these various groups of the society to manufacture a particular medicine. Then it approaches to the manufacturing industries and take help from them to decrease the amount, decrease the cost of that particular medicine to again at a lower level. And then you can get the prizes for a particular invention. You can get the grants from the various government organizations for a particular invention. And in that way, you can replace the patent with various other ways for an innovation. I hope that answers your question. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I shall first ask you all why this debate started. This debate started because of the condition that our medical infrastructure is in, which is very poor. But then again, is it fair to attribute all the liability of these faults in our medical infrastructure to the pharmaceutical companies? Is it not the first prerogative of the government, the legislature, the representatives that people have selected to look after their health? With this, I start my arguments. Ladies and gentlemen, there were two superpowers 15 years ago, 25 years ago. One has fallen, one stands stronger than ever because of profit-based incentive. When profit and morality come at war, profit seldom loses. We're all private individuals. Everybody is working for profit. Now, we can look at two ways. One is we can suggest the NGO way that my friend suggested in his answer. Dear friends, $51.3 billion was spent in research and development in the pharmaceutical industries just in the USA in 2011. That sort of money cannot be given by NGOs. The total collection of NGOs globally is very less as compared to that. So, it cannot be denied that incentive, profit incentive, is what drives these companies. That is what leads these companies to fuel millions and millions of dollars. Secondly, the motion is patents harm a patient's health. Now, when we look at the term health, as defined by WHO, it's not just physical health. It is also economic health, social health, mental health. Ladies and gentlemen, there has been a research by two economists, Robert Shapiro and Aparna Mathur, in 2013, which suggests that if Indian patent system was at par with the Chinese patent system, our FDI inflows would increase by 33% annually. That is, they would be doubled in 3 years. Imagine the jobs created, the infrastructure development created, the betterment of the economy created. All that will add up to the health of the patient. Not just that. See, to rid this debate of any polemic arguments, what we must do is we must choose one particular jurisdiction, and the fairest jurisdiction to choose here is India. Because many provisions like compulsory licensing, like working provisions, do not exist in other countries, but they do here. So if we choose a global debate, then the arguments become more redundant. When we look at the Indian patent system, though, and the Indian Patent Act 1970, I present to you Section 47, Clause 4, which provides that the government may choose to import any drug and distribute it free of cost at its public dispensaries. So the needy patients, the patients that my friend claims are dying because of the lack of availability of the drugs, they only need to look up to the welfare state as it is defined in the Constitution. Furthermore, I present to you our Section 66 of the same Act, which provides that any patent may be revoked in the interest of public welfare. Then again, we only need to look up to our welfare state. It's the prerogative of the state. And even if, oh, before proceeding to my second argument, I would like to address the Novartis case. In the Novartis case, it was I did some fact finding, and it was found that Novartis was providing Glivec, the drug in question, to 95% of the patients free of cost, and the rest 5% of the patients were being provided that cost at very affordable co-pay basis. So even after the Supreme Court has taken away their patent, it has actually harmed the patients, because now other drugs will actually charge where Novartis was not charging. Novartis was dispensing its corporate social responsibility, and that is my second argument. Why do away with the patents? Why not involve corporate social responsibility, just like subsidies? What do? When we look at subsidies, we provide subsidies to the poor, but we do not provide subsidies to the rich. Similarly, I believe that a pharmaceutical company has every right to retain, to take back the money it has spent in innovation of that drug from the people who can afford it, and to the poor people, it can be made compulsory, just like corporate social responsibility. Moving on, the respected judges, it must be understood that no legal prominent personality can justify the righteousness of an action which forces a corporate private entity, a private right, to sell its drugs at a cost lower than the manufacturer of drugs. Now, my friend across the table fails to understand that the cost of manufacturing the drug is not just the cost of its produce in the factory. The millions and millions of dollars spent researching, the millions and millions of dollars spent when only 20% of the drugs pass the trial stage, those millions of dollars are also included in the cost of manufacture, and the corporate personality has the right to recover it. Otherwise, it will be a facet of communism, which has fallen already, because then it will amount to us taking away the money of the pharmaceutical company and distributing it to the poor, because we are not letting the pharmaceutical company take back it. And with this, I say we don't need to do away with patents, we need stronger patents. Thank you.
My question?
Yes, please.
First, a general comment on whatever you have said. As far as we look towards the international agreements like the TRIPS or the TPP or the dominance of the America or the various nations, it doesn't seem that it is a social contract theory which is going on in the international system. It is basically the commercial contract theory, because they are basically favoring the big pharmaceutical companies. So coming to this next step of my questioning is basically, how do you measure innovation? The hidden trial method should be included. Should those hidden trial method be forced on the poor patients so that they can suffer due to the lack of ability of a particular pharmaceutical company to produce a medicine? Because the hidden trial methods cost a lot for a pharmaceutical company, so should it be allowed to take those expenditure from the poor patients? Should it be?
The poor patients only need to look up to the welfare state. But second, the company will stop investing. AIDS has not been cured, cancer has not been completely cured, and I don't see the government putting money into it. I see the private pharmaceutical companies putting money into it, because they want to find new drugs because of profit then again. Furthermore, India being the pharmacy of the world, attracts 2.7% of the global R&D expenditure. US, with its yet stronger IP laws, attracts 31%. So why is that? India is not innovating because no money is coming in, because our patent system is weaker. That's why I propose for a stronger patent system. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Before the debate proceeds further, an important announcement. We have a Popular Choice Award. That is the audience award for the participants. Audience, I request you to kindly note down the name of the participant whose debate you found worth as per your thinking. You know, note down the name of the participant. The participant who gets the maximum number of votes shall be awarded with the Popular Choice Award. Just to give a brief on the participants who have just completed their debate, pair one was, for the motion, was Avinish Kumar. He was from South Asian University. His counterpart against the motion was Ankit Jain Faculty of Law, Delhi. Second pair for the motion was Sandeep from OP Jindal University, and his counterpart against the motion was Aditya Hooda, Faculty of Law, Jamia. Now, I would like to invite on the dais Jayant Bhardwaj, Institution Symbiosis Law School, Noida, for the motion, and against the motion, Varad Chaudhary, first year BA LLB student, Amity Law School, Noida.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am Jayant Bhardwaj from Symbiosis Law School, Noida.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Varad Chaudhary, and I'm a first-year law student at Amity Law School, New Delhi, from IP University, affiliated to IP University. My heartiest welcome to the esteemed judges and the team of Novartis as well, who has generously decided to contribute or sponsor this particular debate despite losing his patent rights in the Supreme Court case. Thank you so much.
उनका हर गुना जमाने को हुनर लगता है. जिनके घर में अमीरी का शजर लगता है, उनका हर गुना जमाने को हुनर लगता है. बदगुमानी का आलम कुछ इस कदर है, हम बात दवा की करते हैं, उन्हें जहर लगता है. This is the new patent age of inventions, of saving bodies and killing souls. For these are the ways to benefit mankind, as true, or perhaps killing them at Waterloo. A very good evening to all of you. However, to me, this salutation of new evening doesn't sound good. I rather welcome you to a new era of new beginning. This is the morning which we need to embrace. An era which is patent free. An era where there are no legal foundations to emancipate mankind. An era where there is no subtle colonialism. And on that note, a very good morning to all of you. We live amidst a universal pandemonium where everything is in a flux, dazed by the sun of transition. And at this time of universal peril, my learned opponents dare to think that patents don't harm the patients. I strongly oppose the motion of what my opponents claim is right. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll give you a moment to ponder upon. A deadly disease, an epidemic, spreads like forest fire, killing people. There exists a medicine which could save their lives and soften the human cry. But oh wait, there is this company XYZ which holds patent rights over it. And it has the power to charge exorbitant amounts over it. Are we moving towards a society? Are we trying to advocate and propagate something to the society that you don't have the right to life if you don't have pockets large enough to pay? I am offended by this idea because this is a scar on my conscience. Moving further, let's see how patents work. Why would any company want to invest in the patent rights for any research? Because the drug is in demand. And why is the drug is in demand? People like consuming medicines? No, they don't. There exists a disease due to which people are dying. It's not out of choice, but out of necessity that they need it. Are we trying to actually give the power to a handful of people to encash someone's plight? Are we as humans in a position to give someone, to control someone, to let someone control what masses crave for? Good morning, everyone. Good morning, it says. Good morning, it is. Let's move further. I'll take you to 1997. Two important things happened in 1997. First of all, I was born. So that seems to be quite important here for my father, who is sitting there and smiling at me. And then another important thing happened in 1997, ladies and gentlemen. India got patent rights over turmeric revoked, which were in 1996 granted to two students from Mississippi University for turmeric to be used as a medicinal cure. The same thing happened in 2005, where the same rights were revoked, which were earlier granted by EPO over neem to be treated as a medicinal cure. My question is, are we all so-called patriotic Indians sitting here not proud of what we call the rich legacy of our medicinal culture? And if this was not colonial infiltration, then what was? A simple question to the house. What was the weapon used? Patents it was. Are we moving towards a society where everything that we are proud of, where everything that we stand for, everything and anything that could be used for emancipation of mankind will be subjected to legal turmoil just because a handful of people want to earn money. Good morning, it says. Good morning, it is. Let's move further. What do patents do? Patents instill in the economy the sense of monopoly. What does monopoly do? It instills distortions and stagnation. How does that happen? How do monopolies extract money? Monopolies extract money on the cost of the patent patients themselves by actually restricting someone to go and provide competitive service to the consumers, that is the patients, which further proves my point that patents indeed harm the patients. Good morning, it says. Good morning, it is. Let's move further. Section 3, Clause B of Indian Patents Act 2005 says, anything, any invention, implied or direct use of which is derogatory to the moral code of conduct and defies the basic code of conduct of morality and defies human, animal or environmental life could not be patented. My question is, what is the grand norm behind it? The grand norm says that anything which is derogatory to human life could not be patented. Then why do we counsel the patents at the first trial when they themselves restrict the power to create, to innovate, to emancipate? At the end, I would like to say, not for the sake of this competition, but for the sake of generations to come, for a better future, let's move towards a better society devoid of materialism, because if not now, then never. I condemn patents by calling them mere weapons of rich, which want to force humanity to suburbs of mediocrity. Jate jate hi sahi wo kahe sach gaya. Maujood har shakhs ka chehra khurach gaya. Hum shukr guzar the ki usne bacha liya. Use ye malal tha ki ye kaise bach gaya. Thank you.
Question?
Ask him a question.
Okay. My question is, I will state two facts and I'll ask you a question. One being that the current state of the research and development in India being abysmal, we are unable to make or invest in creation of a new drug. Secondly, your proposition being that we do not allow patents at all. If in case there is a disease outbreak in India, like Ebola for that matter, how do you propose we aim to solve that particular problem?
Gentlemen, neatly pointed out certain loopholes in the Indian system. So this doesn't make sense to me. The basic fact that there are certain loopholes in a certain system doesn't mean that you give the privilege to a handful of people to control what masses crave for, first thing. Second thing, when you talk about Indian plight, Indian state of, I hereby state the basic motive for the grand norm of Indian constitution is public morality, public welfare, then how can we not hold the government liable for the plight and not give a handful of people to control what masses crave for? Thank you.
The very progress in the medical field as a human civilization. To that end, I shall endeavor to prove to not just my proposition, but to everyone, each and every member of this august gathering, how patents do not harm a patient's health, but rather ensure a patient's health. I shall do this with the medium of three simple points, and the end, I will try to summarize the debate for the benefit of all. It is important to notice that through this course of debate, I shall be referring to patents only in the medical world and medical industry and not anywhere outside. And I shall also be restricting my examples to the Indian context, considering India is the hub of all patent debates, something which the people from Novartis would agree with. Okay. The first off, there is a lack of depth of understanding of the topic itself. Patents in themselves are incapable of harming anyone. The proposition's problems or the arguments are about the processes related to the patents or the various activities of the patent holders and not the patent itself. Because patents are just an exclusive set of rights given to individuals or companies or inventors, that too for a limited period of time, and for the disclosure of their invention. The disclosure of an invention which through time immemorial has always led to the efficient cure of a particular civilian or a particular individual and never harmed them in any way. Which brings me to my second point about the relevance of patents in today's world. Look, every legitimate drug present in the world today is a product of years and years of research, and in and more importantly, the resources which have been invested by individuals and companies in order to procure or in order to make or produce a particular drug. This sort of an investment demands a legitimate return on investment and a legitimate ownership of rights for the particular drug. This not only helps in providing a sense of security to the patent holders, but also ensures the continual innovation of drugs in case of an epidemic in terms of outbreak of diseases. See, logically speaking, researchers would quit innovating if they knew that the drug which they make is not only being copied, but being sold at a very cheap rate without them getting any credit for the same. The royalty of the income which is earned by these particular companies is further invested into R&D, ensuring the sustenance of the operations and also ensuring and also creating new medicines to combat the outbreaks of new diseases. Something again which ensures an effective remedy to the patients and not harm them in any way. Okay, furthermore, let's tackle the problem, the main problem of the proposition, or the only argument of the proposition, which is the commercial exploitation of drugs, and that too in specific cases. The case in point I'll take is again of Novartis, considering it is again at the hub of the debate since 2005, or rather since 1998 when they first filed for the patent. Look, their drug is called Gleevec. It's a cancer drug. They had a patent bid rejected, and that rejection was upheld by the Supreme Court in 2005, primarily because of the amendment to the Indian Patent Act, and specifically Clause 3, Section D. Section 3, Clause D. And that's not only limited just to Gleevec. There are a lot of other companies who have suffered from this particular clause. The problem with that is that people who are salivating, much like my proposition, at the decision of upholding or not giving the patent rights to the particular companies, they're celebrating, but they're missing two basic points. They're celebrating because, yes, there is a considerable cost difference there, considering Gleevec was sold for around $2,600 per patient, whereas the substitute drug or the generic drug made by the companies is sold for $170. But then again, they're missing two very basic points. One being that the Novartis getting that patent doesn't necessarily mean the end of all generic drug companies. They would basically just have to give a royalty, and that to a reasonable royalty as per the grandfather clause in the Indian Patent Act itself. And secondly, and the most importantly being that it is not the responsibility of a pharmaceutical company to provide a drug free of cost or provide a drug relatively cheaper to basically any society. That is and always has been the prerogative of the government of any country. And what's more important to note here is that the government of India has previously in the past incorporated this particular problem through various other means, but the particular way they're choosing right now by restricting patents is massively counterproductive, because they have options like providing subsidies, they have options like providing CSR compulsory for companies, which would lead to companies like Novartis, who have generously again given 16,000 people, which constitute 95% of the people who are suffering from that particular disease that year, the medication free of cost. And more importantly, another very important way forward would be also something known as patent pooling, which is again utilized by Western nations in order to regulate the prices in the market for the particular drug. Now see, the government of India also has various provisions under either national legislations or international agreements like the TRIPS agreement in order to make sure that this happens. But the way forward they're choosing is by restricting patents, or the way forward which is presented by the proposition is by restricting patents, which is counterproductive massively for two reasons. One being that, this particular step effectively spells death of all innovation and R&D in the particular industry. Now, any individual or any company rather would refrain from ever going ahead and even introducing a drug into the market anymore. And secondly, being that with almost no R&D available, there is a massive autonomy given to the generic drug companies, and there is no transparency in that particular autonomy, because the companies can rather misuse that particular opportunity to... Can I just like finally give you a summary of the debate, if it's possible?
We no need to give summary now.
Okay, I'll just finish off this point. I'll give you two scenarios. One given by the.
Okay. We are saying no further. Yes.
Okay. Please. Thank you.
So my question is, how can you say that they anyhow don't harm the patients, right? Patients are somehow restricted for their right, which is benefits we receive from the competition, right? Monopolies are somehow instilled in the economy and create distortions when we talk about patients, somehow giving the firm only right to produce the drug, to research, to further develop the drug, and that would anyhow not provide the other researchers to go about it and actually develop the drug.
Okay. Can you like form a question?
That was a question indeed.
Okay. To tackle that question, primarily, considering you talked about monopoly, like I said in my speech itself, the aspect of monopoly can be tackled and primarily has been tackled by the government before through various steps like providing subsidies, like patent pooling, like incorporating corporate social responsibility in companies, which means there is no monopoly there is no effective monopoly in terms of the price of the particular drug available in the market. Secondly, the aspect of people not having the ability to innovate drugs. Look, India already provides 0.96% of the GDP into R&D. It needs to be increased to 2%, which has been promoted, has been proposed by the government. It hasn't been done so. But by not allowing patents or not allowing foreign drugs in the market or the patents of the foreign drugs in the market, you are depriving the population of any effective remedy at all.
Coming next, for the motion is Zahid Ahmed, third year student, Institution, Faculty of Law, Jamia Millania. Against the motion, Ujjaini Chatterjee, third year law student, Symbiosis Law School, Noida.
Can you give me another paper? I thought it's not in the same thing.
Audience, you're requested to kindly note down your favorite participant's name. Shortly, we'll be circulating a list where you'll be ticking your favorite participants list, and the person winning shall be getting the Popular Choice Award. Thank you.